I'm Rocky Blotta, and I work here part of ERT. I think it's an economic contracting company here at MCDC. And my talk is on the air breathing index and how to use it to estimate profit. Air freezing index, or AFI, is a measure of the combined magnitude and duration of air temperatures above and below the freezing point. In other words, it's basically a value that is the severity of the winter season. And our colleague Jared Greene is going to be talking a little bit more about AFI and his research with it, but our focus on this is how AFI is used as a common index to calculate estimated profit. AFI uses daily mean air temperatures to generate seasonal values. And the AFI season begins August 1st and ends July 31st. So, importance. Research has shown that up to one-third of the U.S. gross domestic product is reliant on accurate weather and climate information. It is our hope that providing AFI and frost depth information, we can help a number of groups, including construction industry, agricultural producers, hydrologists, ecologists, and so on. So, providing frost depth information is really important for how you calculate AFI, because it's one of the confusing things about it. Calculating AFI, basically, is the daily departures above and below the freezing point that are accumulated and plotted to create a seasonal curve. So if we start with the Asheville Co-op as an example here, if we had to plot the daily departures, which is the difference between the mean air temperature and the 32 degrees Fahrenheit, we would plot those daily departures beginning August 1st, 1976 until July 31st, 1977. This is where our seasonal curve would look like. Now the seasonal AFI value is the difference between the highest and lowest inflection points on the seasonal curve. So, in our example, the highest and lowest inflection points are 3,365, and our lowest is 3,147. The difference between those two inflection points is 218. So this is the AFI value for Asheville for the 76-77 year. To provide a comparison, I wanted to display Asheville with a few other locations that I believe some of our attendees are from. So there in the top right corner, you've got the Asheville 218 value. And you can see the comparison of the seasonal curves between different areas. Like Charleston, South Carolina, you have an AFI value of 14. Kansas City, Missouri, AFI value of 722. And Ithaca, New York, an AFI value of 1,171. Now, the point of doing this is to show basically a visual of how AFI values represent not only the magnitude of the winter season, but also the duration of the winter season. Now, converting AFI to frost depth. We did this, we basically took these seasonal values for all the stations in our study, those 5,599 stations we used. We calculated all the seasonal values for two different climate normal periods, the first period being 1951 to 1980, and the second being 1981 to 2010. This gave us 29 values per station per period. We took these 29 values for each station, for each period, and inputted them into a Weibull probability distribution. This generated return period values. So using the same four stations as examples in the last slide, this would be the return period values for the 1951 and 1980 period. Then we were able to convert these values to frost depth. Now, we were interested in maximum depth of frost penetration, so what we did is we used the 100-year return values. And if you were to convert this, you would get these approximate frost depths. So in Charleston, the frost depth would be about 4 inches. In Asheville, North Carolina, it's about 19. Kansas City, it's approximately 46 inches. And in Ithaca, New York, it's 59 inches. Now, we made this conversion from AFI to frost depth using research done by Brown in 1964. And you can see on the table, he basically created a this relationship between air temperature and frost depth. Now, we were able to take the equation of this line and apply it to the data set, so we didn't have to manually do this or anything. But for fun, if you were to plot the 100-year return values here, you can see that the should be, because we're using the same equation, so. Now, process. So we had 5,599 stations, each station having 60-year continuous data record through both periods. We wanted to display this information in GIS, so this is our distribution of stations, as you can see here. Then we decided to map the maximum process and interpolate across the entire CONUS. So here's our 1951 to 1980 period, and our 1981 to 2010 period. I know this is a little difficult to see, but the point of it is to really show the comparison between the change over these two periods. So in this map, you can see that this map is displaying the process value change between the two periods. Our results show that about 73% of our stations increased a reduction in process, while 23% of the stations experienced an increase in the process. And I wanted to highlight the scale of that in the legend down at the bottom. And you can see that basically the colors in blue are the ones that experience an increased process, and the yellows, orange, and reds are all experiencing a decrease. With that said, I wanted to highlight a little bit more about this effect of visual on this. So if you were just display all the locations that experienced at least 5 centimeters, greater than 5 centimeters, our map would look like this. And greater than 10, and 15. At 20 centimeters or greater, you can see that most of the cooling is disappeared besides right there above the Idaho and Oregon border there. And of course, anything 25 centimeters or greater is just on the warming side. We also looked at the trend for the CONUS. If you were to take the mean AFI for all 5,599 stations and plot that mean, this is what you would see here. Our R-square is not significant, but the 60-year record does show a decreasing trend over the period. We also did this at a regional scale. And we wanted to bring this map back up so you can kind of see the relationship. There is a lot, there's been cooling, of course, down in the south and southeast, but if you look at the AFI value, it's pretty minimal, so the frost depth is minimal, as opposed to the northern Rockies where you see much of the warming, and you can see that the frost depth is obviously much more significant. We're currently working with NCDC on data governance process to make this a product. It's been proposed that this would be part of the supplemental normals. We hope to offer things, seasonal AFI values, return period values, frost depths, and everything. We also would like to offer the AFI and frost depth maps, make them available as well. And if all things go well, this is supposed to be available sometime, estimated at the end of the year, October-ish timeframe. Some references.